Yes, so actually I'm working on GIS, which is Geographic Information System. They are software specifically made for the handling on geographic data. So they allow all new kind of functionalities on mapping, on developing interactive mapping, and I feel it's very powerful. In my case, I'm applying the GIS technology in a customized way on the study on Public-Access Defibrillation, which is actually the distribution on the city's territory of publicly accessible automated external defibrillators, which is actually a very important issue because we're talking about out-of-hospital cardiac arrest, which is very serious medical condition with a high incidence rate. I mean, statistics say that it affects one person over 1,000 every year, with a very low survival probability, it's below 10% usually, and also with a high risk of developing permanent disabilities. So the point is that the limit for an effective intervention is very small. We consider a medical reference of 6 minutes. And that's why public access defibrillation was born, in order to reduce the time of the first defibrillation. So it allows people to actually defibrillate before the arrival of the ambulance itself and of emergency medical system. So in my case, specifically, I'm handling the special distribution of the defibrillators. And as you can imagine, it requires a very geographical approach. And that's why the crossing of GIS and EMS come into place in my work. I mean that the most important thing is that it is a very useful resource. I mean, it's very easy to, it's very effective to in order to increase the survival probability of people, to defibrillate them, but it requires to be done in a very limited time. So there are many defibrillators placed in the cities, but they are very low used because there is no awareness about this. So I hope that my project could provide some insight to the EMS provider, but also to raise awareness of people about this issue. Yes, so currently the guidelines for the installation of public defibrillators say that they must be placed into public places like squares or in the subway, in train stations. But we discovered that in most cases, from 80 to almost 90% of the arrests occur in residential location, so in houses. That's why the old model should be rethought. I mean, I'm not saying that the guidelines are wrong, because when an arrest occurs in a public place, it is more likely to be treated with a defibrillator. But since almost 90% of the arrests are in the residential areas, I think that covering a residential area could be more effective in order to reduce the time of first defibrillation in most cases. Yes, part of our analysis is to compute the catchment area, which is actually the area in which a defibrillator could be potentially retrieved and applied to the victim within the time limit. We do consider a limit of 200 meters on topological areas, so based on the actual topology of the roads, but currently there is no scientific evidence about how to dimension the catchment areas. So we are still working on this issue. We are considering a dimension of 200 meters because it is close to what the guidelines suggest. Actually, the guidelines are still based on a circular area of 100 meters, and we discovered that a topological area with a target dimension of 200 meters can be close to that one. So, but still, there is still some research to do about the dimensioning. When I talk about residential areas, I mean we developed a whole risk map in order to compute the relation within some attributes that are related to the geography of the area and the probability of occurrence of arrests. So we're trying to cross this information in order to actually map the risk and optimize the distribution.